I saw our fearless leader on the screen. I wrote a book, Chimpanzee Politics, very long ago. I feel we live in the U.S. at the moment in a time of chimpanzee politics. The behavior is so similar. I don't know if you heard these recent stories that the spokesperson for the White House had to hide in the bushes. Did you see that one? Did you see that the head of the FBI, who was just fired, had to blend in with the curtains? He didn't want to meet Trump, and so he had a blue costume on, and he stood against the blue curtains, hoping that no one would notice him. This is primatology at its best, I think. So, blending in with the environment. But I'm going to speak about something totally different. I started my career working on aggression and violence. At the time that I was a student, this was all people could talk about. Konrad Lorenz had written a book in the 60s. The Austrian ethologist. And everyone was studying violence and aggression at the time, and I, as a student, was doing the same thing. And in that context, by accident, I discovered that chimpanzees, after fights, they kiss and embrace, and I got very interested in that. Much more interested, I think, than in the aggression. And so that's put me on a path, and that's what I will describe in this lecture, of looking at what I call socially positive behavior. Instead of the conflict, which is clearly, I'm not denying that there's aggression in primate societies, but instead of looking at the conflict side, I'm looking at the, let's say, the friendships and the cooperation and the empathy, and I have done a lot of studies on that. So I live in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm a southern boy, as we say, even though I'm from Holland originally. And the topics I will be describing are reconciliation, empathy, self-awareness. I will say a few things about pro-social behavior and fairness. We do a lot of studies on fairness at the moment. And I will, on occasion, mention elephants, because apart from the primate work, we do a little bit of elephant work. I'm going to try not to walk too much in front of the pictures. This is a picture of actually the first sort of situation that I saw when I started working with chimpanzees. These are two male chimpanzees who were in a fight. The fight ends up in a tree. The fight is mostly non-physical, of course, as in most primates. And so they scream and yell at each other, and they end up in a tree. And one of them now holds out his hand and begs the other for contact. And that's where you get after this, a second after this, you get a kiss and embrace between the two, and that's the reconciliation. And so when I discovered that, there was no room for that in the literature. The whole literature was about competition and aggression, and winning is good, losing is bad, nothing in between, and reconciliation, clearly people had no concept of what that could be. So this is a definition that we use, friendly reunion between former opponents not long after a conflict. And if you take that as the definition of a reconciliation, you're actually going to find it not just in chimpanzees, you're going to find it in many species. This is a typical one for chimps. This is a male chimp who attacks a female. The female comes back to him, like 10 minutes later or so. She offers her hand for a hand kiss, which is where our hand kiss comes from. No, I don't think so. I think our hand kiss is an independent invention. But it's interesting because it's a way of testing the male and reassuring him. It's, and testing, because if he's nasty, he may bite. You know, it's a way of testing. And then they proceed to a mouse-to-mouse kiss, which is the typical reconciliation. And so reconciliation is actually very common in the chimpanzee. Since chimpanzees have a lot of fights, it's quite an aggressive species, they have also lots of reconciliations. I always find it interesting that I discovered it being from a family of six boys. And so I think that has contributed to my perception of this, because of course if you have a large family, there's lots of fights and lots of reconciliations always going on. This is stump-tailed monkeys. You know the difference between monkeys and apes, I hope. You are basically all apes. You are tailless primates. There is, for the biologist, not much difference between you and the apes. There's 1.5% DNA difference between you and chimpanzees. So you are basically all apes. Monkeys are a different category. And I don't know in your language how it is, but in Dutch the distinction is not as clear as between monkey and ape. We have mensapen and apen, and you probably have something similar. But monkeys are a totally different category of primates. And for example, monkeys, they can reconcile, like these monkeys do, without making eye contact. Monkeys, in this case, this is the stump-tailed macaque, they do what we call a hold bottom. One of them presents the butt, the other one holds the hips. And many species reconcile without eye contact, but apes and humans cannot do this. There's many similarities between humans and apes, of course, because we are apes. But humans don't reconcile without eye contact. If you have a fight with your boss, or you go to his office, and you talk with him, and he keeps staring at the ceiling, or staring in his coffee, and doesn't look at you, you will not feel reconciled, I can assure you. So that's monkeys, and monkeys do this. The way we measure it, I'm a scientist, and I'm going to show you a little bit of science on occasion. The way we measure it is we take a 10-minute observation. So for example, you have a spontaneous fight between two monkeys. You follow those two monkeys for 10 minutes, and that's called a post-conflict observation. And you see how often do they have contact. And as you see here, it's about, 50%, 60% of the time, they have a friendly contact after their fight. Then you do a control observation on a different day where they had no fight at the same time of day, and you see what they normally do, and you see they do much less. What this difference is called post-conflict attraction. And it's exactly the opposite of what I learned as a student. As a student, I learned aggression drives individuals apart. Aggression is a dispersive mechanism. And what you see here is actually aggression brings individuals together. And this is true for species after species after species. Aggression does not drive individuals apart. Aggression actually brings them together. It's very counterintuitive maybe, but that's how it works. Then we found reconciliation after the primates. We found it in goats and hyenas and dolphins and elephants and you name it. There's basically every social mammal, and there's also some bird studies, every social mammal has reconciliation behavior. And now we are at the point that if we don't find it, we're very surprised. If we have a social species that doesn't reconcile, we wonder how do they keep their society together? How can you keep a society with potential conflict together without having a reconciliation mechanism? There's only one animal that has been tested, a mammal that has no reconciliation, and many of you have that animal at home, is the domestic cat. Now, the domestic cat is a solitary hunter, doesn't need it. Who cares if you're a solitary hunter and you have no buddies? But I bet the lion, for example, which is a cooperative hunter, has reconciliation. I don't think it has been studied, but I bet it. This is what children do. If you do observations at the schoolyard, as we did, you find the exact same pattern. When children are young, they do it physically. They embrace. If they're older, they do it verbally. They say, "You can play with my truck," and that's a reconciliation. And there's actually very interesting cultural differences. People have tested this all over the world. Japanese children, for example, reconcile a lot more than American children. And they say, I'm not the expert on this, but they say that that's because Japanese teachers don't interfere. Maybe if the kids kill each other, but other than that, they don't interfere in fights, and so the kids have to, for themselves, they have to find out how to reconcile. Instead of teachers, like American teachers, always meddling with everything, and as soon as there's a fight, they break it up, and they ask people to shake hands, which is sort of the opposite of teaching them how to reconcile. This is how human adults do it. This is when Obama was still a senator, he had a big fight with McCain, who's a very prominent senator, and this was played out in the Washington Post, and Obama basically lost the fight. And the photographer acted a bit like a primatologist. He took pictures of the actual reconciliation, which I appreciate. And so they shook hands and they made up. And the expression on Obama's face really interests me. This is what in primatology we call the bulging lips face. So male chimpanzees do it. When male chimpanzees confront each other with all their hair up and they try to intimidate each other, and the one who withdraws, so the one who loses and probably regrets that he started this, has that bulging lips. You can try it for yourself. You can try to press air under your lips and make that face, has that kind of face. and it's a very common face. It's a... I have an enormous collection of it. It is a face that politicians show when they have lost. They are ashamed and they have lost something, they regret something, like Clinton had a lot to regret at this point, you know. So it's a male face. I've never seen it on women. It's either that, also not female leaders. It's either that women never regret anything, which is possible, or they just don't have the face. And I'm always waiting for, you know, my German audiences, they have a female leader. I'm always waiting for some scandal to break out. It hasn't happened yet. But it's a male expression. And if you start looking for it, also in Danish politics, you will see it. It happens. In the Dutch politics, I have lots of pictures of this. As a side note, and after this I'm going to get to empathy. As a side note, we are doing at the moment observations in the operating rooms of the hospital. Emory Hospital is one of the biggest in the US. And there are too many conflicts in operating rooms. Operating rooms are supposed to be places of cooperation, teamwork, you know, to save the life of a patient and so on. But everywhere, not just in the US, all over the world, there's too many conflicts in the operating rooms. And if you ask people afterwards, which is the standard methodology of social science, I don't know how many of you are psychologists or anthropologists or whatever, the social sciences work with questionnaires. That's what they like. I don't trust a word of what people tell me. I'm so happy to work with animals who cannot fill out questionnaires. So, but that's what they do, and then they ask people afterwards what happened in the operating room, and they get all the wrong answers. And so I have an observer sitting in the operating room who takes data the way we do on the primates, and that's the only reliable way, I think, to know what happens. And I can't tell you much about the results yet. So empathy. This is a dictionary definition of empathy. The ability to understand and share the feelings of another. And you immediately see the two components of empathy. You see the understanding part, which is the cognitive part, and the feeling part, which is the emotional part. Now, if you ask the average psychologist what is empathy, he will come with the cognitive story. He will say it's to imagine how others feel. It's to put yourself in their shoes. And it's a cognitive story. But without the emotions, it won't work at all. For example, a psychopath is very good at the cognitive part. Psychopaths are very good at imagining your situation and then getting all your money or something like that, or murdering you if that's necessary. So the emotional part is essential, and I basically divide empathy in two channels. One is the body channel, which is synchronization, which is so old in the animal kingdom. Fish and birds and all sorts of animals synchronize. Synchronization, motor mimicry, that's where the mirror neurons come in probably. Emotional contagion, being affected by the emotions of others. So that's the body channel. You talk with a sad person, you will have a sad expression on your face. You talk with a happy person who's laughing, you will probably be laughing. That's the body channel. It's an automatic channel. It starts on day one of life. Babies cry when they hear other babies cry. Sometimes on an airplane, there's 10 babies who cry. So that's the emotional contagion. They have tested actually against other sounds. It's specifically baby crying that does it. You can play the sounds of cars or vacuum cleaners, that doesn't do it. It's baby cry. And girl babies do it already more than boy babies. So the sex difference in empathy that we see all over the mammals is already there. So that's the body channel. Then you have the perspective taking, which is more complex. So now you need to draw a line between yourself and the other. You're affected by the emotions of the other, you adopt the emotions of the other, but now you need to understand that their situation is not your situation. So you need to have a stronger self-identity, and then you can take the perspective of the other, sort of understand their situation. Not a lot of animals, I think, are capable of this. Humans are capable of this, and humans only after a certain age, actually, are capable of this. So that's the perspective-taking part, and we'll get to that also. Now, the body synchronization part, we study yawn contagion. Yawn contagion is actually a very good indicator of empathy. Yawn contagion, for example, autistic children who have trouble with empathy, they have less yawn contagion. People who score high on empathy measures, they're very sensitive to the yawns of others. Women have more yawn contagion than men. So all these things sort of fit together with the idea that it is related to empathy. And we study that in the primates who do a lot of yawning. And of course, all the vertebrates yawn, fish yawn, birds yawn. No one knows why we yawn. This is a good question if you're a young scientist. Throw yourself on the yawning part. You will have a lot of yawning audiences also. Which you shouldn't take as an offense. So we show our chimps yawn videos. So this is a chimp who's looking at an iPod on which we show yawning apes. This is another one. And they're very sensitive to them. This experiment has been tried on dogs, and dogs, this, you can try this at home. Dogs will even yawn if you play the sound of the owner yawning to their ear. It's interesting. Now, a data point that's interesting is we have two sets of videos. One is in-group, meaning chimps who live together. One is out-group, meaning chimps that they don't know, they've never seen before. And they only do the yawn contagion with chimps that they know, not with the strangers. This is the same as in humans. In humans, there's an Italian team who has gone around in waiting rooms and train stations to see how people yawn together. And if you stand next to a stranger who yawns, you're going to be unaffected. You stand next to your wife who yawns, you're going to be yawning. So they found that same bias, and that's a sort of universal bias, almost a characteristic of empathy. Empathy is more generated, more easily generated between individuals who are familiar and similar. There's a drawback here, there's a flip side. We have trouble having empathy for people who are quite different from us. Different age group, different language, different culture, different race, and so on. We have trouble with that. And so empathy is always biased. That's almost per definition the case. And this is what the chimps show also. So now bonobos. Bonobos are the most empathic apes. And I started working with bonobos in the 1980s, and I gave them the label the make love, not war primates. That is now, they're called the primate hippies and so on. And it's because they are much less violent than chimpanzees. And they're not very popular among anthropologists. Anthropologists keep going back to the chimpanzee, even though the bonobo is exactly equally close to us as the chimpanzee. But they keep throwing the chimp around as the best model of human ancestry. And that is because bonobos are female-dominated, and they're too peaceful, and too sexy also. So they have a lot of things against them. They would fit well here, I think, but the anthropologists hate them because they're too peaceful. And I always try to make the argument is that I'm not convinced that humans have always waged war, as they say. There's no evidence for that, actually. The evidence for human warfare goes back 12,000 years, that's all. We don't have evidence from before that, but anyway. So the bonobo, this is a human evolutionary tree, the way anthropologists drew it in the 60s. Humans, completely separate, and then we have the apes. 25 million years of separate human evolution. Then in the 60s, we found DNA and started comparing it. And this is the DNA tree. According to the DNA tree, we are right in the middle of the apes. We are very close to bonobos and chimps. We are a little bit more distant from the gorilla, more distant from the orangutan. Ardipithecus falls here somewhere. According to this DNA tree, and that's why no one even wanted to believe it in the beginning, a bonobo is more like a human than a bonobo is like a gorilla. People couldn't stand that idea. And so the anthropologists kept trying to debunk it, but they couldn't fight against DNA. That was just a lost fight that they had there. And if you think of this tree here, the way this was done was based on teeth and skull and leg bones and so on. And for example, one of the arguments of anthropologists was, we humans, we walk on two legs. That's very special. But you know, chickens walk on two legs. As a biologist, I'm not impressed by walking on two legs. I don't think it's a big deal. And bonobos are very good at walking on two legs. This is bonobos. Bonobos have the same body proportions, almost exactly the same as Ardipithecus, who lived 4.4 million years ago, is a bipedal ancestor of us. Same body proportions in terms of legs relative to the body. The feet are even very similar, which is remarkable. The brain size, very similar. So basically, Ardipithecus looked like an upright bonobo. And so I think the bonobo is actually a very interesting model of human ancestry. Now, this is how bonobos make up after fights. They do everything with sex, so they also make up with sex. This is known as the missionary position, as you probably know. That's an interesting side story. It has nothing to do with my talk, but... I once wanted to know where the term missionary position came from. And I ended up in some old German anthropology literature where they claimed that they claimed that the face-to-face copulation was a Western invention that other people in the world did not know about, and the missionaries needed to tell them about it. So my bonobos did this all without the missionary, I think. But it's a very strange idea, because if you look at human genital anatomy, we are built for the frontal copulation, like the bonobos actually also are. We are anatomically designed for that kind of copulation, so I don't know where the argument came from. So bonobos, the easiest way to get sex among bonobos is to give them food. And that is because food induces competition, as it does in all species. And bonobos, their most effective way of resolving competition is sex. So as soon as they have something attractive around, they're going to be copulating. So I'll show you how this goes. This is at a sanctuary where we do studies. These bonobos are now waiting for feeding time. These are not wild bonobos. They're waiting for the feeding time. They're sitting around. Now the food has arrived and they're copulating. So they're basically multitasking. But they're very effective. It's a very effective way to resolve problems. Now, a reconciliation. You're going to see a reconciliation here in the river. You will see a little fight that is instigated by food that is dropped into the river. You will see the fight, and you will see immediately after see the reconciliation. For this, I need sound, so I hope that there's sound. And that's it. So, people always think that bonobos must have sex like 8 hours a day or something. 10 seconds is a long time for bonobos. And you basically have to look at it as a genital handshake or something like that. So that's how bonobos do it. But they do it all the time, and it's extremely effective. Now we're getting closer to what you normally would call empathy. So empathy in terms of, let's say, yawn contagion or physical mimicry and so on is one thing, but consolation is actually the closest you get to typical types of empathy. This is a dog. It's actually sort of interesting, the dog study, but I won't talk about the dog. So the first studies of human empathy were done by an American scientist, Carolyn Zahn Wachsler, who worked with children. And she said she would go to a family and put up a video camera, and she would ask a family member to cry. And then she would see how young children responded. And very young children, before they even can walk, they would crawl up, but certainly if they could walk, they would walk up to the person who is crying or coughing or saying that they're in pain, and would touch them and stroke them and so on. And she called that an act of empathic concern. And she started investigating that. At the time, it was a sort of taboo topic. She told me that her science was not taken seriously. No one was interested in empathy. They said it was a women's magazine's topic. So that's how... That was the resistance to human empathy. So you can imagine animal empathy if you talk about that. She found in the same studies, by the way, that the dogs in the family would do the same thing. Very interesting. And she already told me that she felt that if we call it empathy in children, we should call it empathy in dogs too. This is an act of consolation in bonobos. So it's a very similar situation. We don't induce the distress. We just wait for a spontaneous case where bonobos have a fight. And then we look at, in this case, the loser of the fight is embraced by somebody else. And actually, bonobos and chimpanzees, more than monkeys, the apes do this kind of thing all the time. So comforting someone who's distressed, they do this all the time. It's a very typical behavior for them. I'm going to show you a consolation. This is a baby bonobo, maybe 3 or 4 years old, who gets bitten by a female and screams, and you will see what happens after that.
Ben, didn't you just attacked Mila?
So that's a typical consolation for the bonobo. It is very recognizable, of course, for us. People who have young children, they're in the consolation business the whole day, basically. So we recognize that behavior, and it's an act of empathy. My first reaction was, when I heard that from the scientist who worked on children, I said, well, if you call that empathy, I'm going to call what my chimps do, empathy also. And so initially, there was quite a bit of resistance because people associated empathy with far too complex things, in my opinion. And so there was resistance. But now we have, and I'll show you some rodent studies. We have studies on all sorts of empathy in animals now. It's a very burgeoning field, actually. So we do these studies on the bonobos. It's sort of sad situation. We do that at a sanctuary. It's sad that the sanctuary exists. It's the only bonobo sanctuary in the world. It's in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Well, the word democratic you can just as well remove. It's the Republic of the Congo. The bonobos there are all traumatized orphans. So basically, we have hunting and poaching going on, the bushmeat hunting, and the poachers, they bring the meat to the market. But baby bonobos, they keep alive because they can sell them for more money than meat. And so they bring these baby bonobos, they're confiscated, they're brought to the sanctuary, they're raised by humans, but all of them are traumatized orphans. Except for a few, you see a few here that are born in the colony, so they are raised by their mother. So we have a few mother-reared ones as well. And that's a very interesting comparison because traumatized orphans, we have a lot of studies on that in Romanian orphanages, on human traumatized orphans. So human traumatized orphans are mentally very disturbed, but emotionally even more. Emotionally, they have lost their emotion regulation. They have no empathy for others. And so it's a very interesting category. Actually, you would expect very little empathy in these bonobos. So this is actually data on this. This is how often they show consolation for someone who's distressed. And you see the adults do only half of it of the juveniles, meaning that the older a bonobo gets, the more selective they become. This doesn't mean that they have less empathy for others, but they become more and more selective. But then if you look at the mother-reared ones, and we only have juveniles for those, you see they do far more than anybody else. And that's what we expected also, is that the mother-rearing gives them a more emotional balance, and that makes that they have more empathy for others. So that fits very well with the human data, actually. Then we wanted to get at the emotion regulation, and that's very complicated if you work with animals that basically we have no control over them. They just interact spontaneously. And so the measure that we used was how long do they take to recover from distress. So you see it goes up to 200 seconds, meaning how long do they scream after they have been attacked by somebody, for example. Now if you scream for 200 seconds, that's like 3 minutes. That's an enormous amount of distress. And if you do that kind of correlation, this is how often they console others. So how much empathy do they show to others? You find a very nice correlation between the two, is that the ones who have the most trouble getting over their own distress are also the ones who do least of the consolation to others. So that fits very nicely also with the human data, where they say that emotion regulation is the key to showing empathy for others. Now, after that, we started studying elephants, and other people started studying dogs, and now we have rodent studies on consolation. And so actually, basically, The empathy studies have really taken off and includes a lot of mammals. There's even some bird studies in there. And certainly elephants show conservation behavior. Now, we recently got involved in a rodent study, and I'm not going to give you all the details on it, but the thing that bothered me was in my own studies is that I could never do the neuroscience. With elephants and chimpanzees or bonobos, first of all, I don't want to do the neuroscience that would be required, but it's also practically almost impossible to do. And so with the rodents, of course, a lot of neuroscience is being done on the rodents. And this student, James Burkett, he discovered that the voles, they console each other after distress. And so the prairie voles, they have a monogamous bond. And if you separate the male from the female, and you bring them back after that together, and one of them is stressed, they will engage in grooming behavior. And so you can study the neuroscience of that kind of consolation behavior, and that's what we did. And I'm not going to go into the details of it, but basically we found that there's the same social bias. So the social bias that we find in all empathy studies, basically in all species, is that the prairie voles only console mates and siblings. They don't console strangers. There's emotional contagion, is that the stress level, which you can physiologically measure, so with corticosterone, the stress level is exactly the same between two partners. So if the female is very stressed, the male is going to be very stressed. If the female is very little stressed, the male is going to be very little stressed. It's actually the same as in humans. In human studies, this has been done where you bring five students in a situation where one of them is stressed by giving a lecture to the other four. That's the stress that they do. And the more stressed the speaker is, the more stressed the audience is. And you can measure that with saliva samples. You can measure the cortisol level. And so, for example, if I would be standing here trembling and shaking and sweating and because I'm totally nervous, you would all be totally nervous too. And we could measure that in your cortisol levels. So that's emotional contagion in action, basically. And then we also found in the same study that oxytocin is involved. And oxytocin, if you block the oxytocin receptors, the behavior disappears. So basically now our conclusion is that the empathy of the rodent, and probably also the chimpanzee and the human, is all basically neurologically identical. It's the same process. And the origin of empathy, we think, is maternal care. So in all the mammals, maternal care is obligatory. And if whether you're an elephant or a mouse, if your offspring is distressed, you need to respond. If they're cold or hungry or in danger, you need to respond to their emotional signals. And that's also why females have more of it than males. That's also why oxytocin is very much involved in it. So all of that fits together with the idea of maternal care being the origin of empathy. Now, to say a few things, I'm not going to say a lot of things about the perspective-taking part. So that's the more cognitive part of empathy. This requires that you set yourself apart. It requires more self-identity. We think it correlates with mere self-recognition. And there's actually human studies where they have looked at the development of empathy in children, and they find that exactly at the time, which is around 18 months to 24 months, and exactly at the time that children start to recognize themselves in the mirror is the time that they start to show more complex forms of empathy. So we think mirror self-recognition itself is not particularly interesting, I think, but mirror self-recognition gets at that self-identity issue. And that's why we started doing studies on mirror self-recognition. One of the expressions of perspective taking is what I call targeted helping. It's where you provide help that is geared specifically to the situation of the other and requires you to understand that situation. So that is perspective taking. You can sort of put yourself in their shoes. This is a picture that a field worker sent to me of bonobos. This is a bonobo female who has a finger in a snare, one of those poacher snares, which are terribly dangerous because not only can her finger fall off, her whole hand can fall off. So it's a very damaging thing. That's why everyone is extremely interested in it. And this old female is going to work on trying to get it off. So that requires some technical understanding also, requires understanding how dangerous it is and how painful it is. And you can see in their expressions that they have some understanding of the specific situation of the other. So that's targeted helping. Here you get targeted helping in an elephant. This elephant, young elephant, has been trying to get out of the ditch for hours, has been working and is getting totally exhausted, is unable to get out of the ditch. This is in Indonesia somewhere. And you will see how this is solved by an adult elephant. So that requires some understanding of the situation of the other, and I think some animals with large brains, like dolphins and apes and elephants, they have that capacity. So there's actually an experiment on it, which was recently done on apes. This was done in Japan, where they would give one chimpanzee a situation where she would need one particular tool to get at food, and the other one had a choice of seven tools. So this one would need to look at the situation of the other, judge that situation, pick out the right tool that fit with the situation, and be willing to give it to them, and that's what the chimps did. And so that's targeted helping, in this case, in an experiment. And so we now have pretty good evidence for this kind of perspective taking. Now, to move from emotional contagion to targeted helping. So emotional contagion, I think, occurs in all the mammals, from rodent to human. Targeted helping is maybe more limited, where you have some sort of perspective taking, requires self-other distinction and probably correlates with mirror self-recognition. And that's why we were very interested in mirror self-recognition in both apes and elephants, and I'll show you the elephant later. So this is Rowena, one of our chimps who uses our iPhone as a mirror. She has a little hole in her head, which was caused by a male. And so she's using our iPhone to look at it and inspect it. It's very typical, it's something that chimps do all the time. So, your average dog is not doing this. And if your dog does this, you call me. and I will probably be skeptical. But the chimps do this all the time. So if I walk up to my chimps with my sunglasses on, they will open their mouths and look inside their mouths, which is a part of your body you never get to see, but you feel the whole day. They're very interested in that. The females will turn around to look at their behind. They're very interested in the behinds. The males never do that. The males are interested in the female behinds, but not in their own behinds. This is what a monkey does. This is a capuchin monkey. So the monkey is very interested. It's very interested in the mirror, but is not using it to inspect itself. Just like your cats and dogs, they don't inspect themselves with the mirror. So that's the big difference of mirror self-recognition. And that's why we started testing elephants. Elephants had been tested, but they had failed a mirror test. But they had been tested, believe it or not, on a mirror of about this size. And so that's always, the methodology is always an issue. And so we decided we needed something bigger. This is me sitting on Pepsi the elephant. This is Josh Plotnick marking Pepsi. And he's marking on one side of the head a cross, a white cross, and on the other side of the head he puts what we call a sham mark. He uses the same paint but without the color in it and puts it on the other side. So the elephant feels being marked on two sides. But the only mark he can see with the help of the mirror, not without without the mirror, is the white mark. This is Pepsi in front of the mirror. Here Pepsi has been marked on the left. It's a very big mirror, as you see, and it's a mirror behind. He can also walk behind it, which is important. And so he's now inspecting the mark.
Yacht.
And here, this is a different day, and Pepsi has been marked on the right-hand side now. Yeah, he's tasting it. It's a non-toxic paint. Now look at what he does at the very end here. So just like the chimpanzees, he wants to look inside his mouth. So before I go on, the conclusion from this for us, because this sort of confirmed our view, is that the more complex forms of empathy we see in animals, those are probably animals who have some sort of self-awareness, at least at the level that they can recognize themselves in the mirror. And actually, the elephants have recently been tested by Josh on something very different from the mirror. They have been tested on a platform, and they would need to step on a platform, and they could pick up a stick and then give it to the experimenter and get some food for it. Then what they do is they attach the stick to the platform with a rope. So now you step on the platform, you try to give the stick, but you can't because it's stuck. And does the elephant understand that it has to step off the platform to do that, meaning that it understands that its own body is blocking the performance, and that's what they do. And so that's also something you can try with your dog, and your dog will probably fail that. So we started doing tests on prosocial behavior. This is on chimpanzees to see, because empathy you can measure in many different ways. So in this case, we wanted to see, do they care about the well-being of somebody else? And this is actually the chimps that I work with. I have two groups of these. This is my office here. I have an office that overlooks the chimps. And so they live in that kind of environment. And then we call them into a room by name. They all have names, of course. It's not only that they know their names, they know each other's names. You can ask one chimp to get another for you. And so they come then into the cognition room, as we call it, and that's where we test them. And in this particular experiment, it was very simple. We have them exchange tokens, and they can either get both food for a token or one of them is food for a token. I'll explain how this goes. So this is the experiment. Two color tokens. They know that the tokens give them food. They don't know what the colors do. They have to learn that. So here you have a bucket full of tokens. They have a partner sitting next to them, and they have a little table on which we can put tokens. So here you get a selfie choice. This chimp picks a token, a red token, gives it to us. We put it on the table to remind them of their choice. And only the one on the right who made the choice gets the food. The partner gets nothing. The partner is now going to express her opinion. The partner has an opinion about the choice. Now you get the pro-social choice. She gives us a green token. And the green token we put also on the table, and now we feed both chimps. So that's the whole difference. You put tokens back into the bucket. We want to keep the same numbers in there. And that's the whole experiment. We do this 30 times in a row. And of course, by the end, the chimps, they're very smart. They know what these two colors are doing. Now, which one do they prefer? The chimp who makes the choices, for that chimp, it doesn't make any difference. Every token that she gives us, she gets food. Same food. So who cares? If she was indifferent to the well-being of others, she wouldn't care about the colors. But this is what we find, is they prefer the pro-social token most of the time. If the partner draws attention to herself by vocalizing and climbing around and stuff like that, they make even more pro-social choices for the partner. If the partner puts pressure on them by spitting water and yelling at them and banging at the window and stuff like that, they make less pro-social choices. So they don't like that kind of behavior. And this is what they do without a partner. So we were the first, after a long period where people claimed that only humans care about the well-being of others, after that long period where that was the case, we were the first to demonstrate that actually chimps do care about the well-being of others. And now we have, I think, 5 or 6 experiments like this. I mentioned already the tool use experiment of chimpanzees, but there's also a beautiful experiment on bonobos where they give a bonobo a whole pile of fruit. The bonobo can eat all the fruit by himself, but he has also learned that there's a door that he can open behind which sits another bonobo. And most of the time, that's what they do. They first go to the door, they open it, the other one comes in, and they have to share all that food with the other one. So there's now several of these studies, and the whole idea that only humans care about the well-being of others is now out of the window, as so many claims. I mean, in my lifetime, I've seen like 25 of these kind of claims, like theory of mind or all the kind of nonsense, has all completely disappeared. We do cooperation studies to see if chimpanzees can handle competition, because that was another one of those other many claims that they couldn't do that kind of thing. And so we set up experiments on cooperation. This is one of the first cooperation studies, which was done at Yerkes like 100 years ago, of 2 juvenile chimps who were pulling in a box. It's a heavy box, too heavy for one of them. There's food on the box, otherwise they wouldn't be pulling. And there they go. Now what they do is they feed one of the 2 chimps. So one of the 2 chimps has his belly full, doesn't want to work anymore. You'll see how that goes. Now look at what happens at the end. This one basically eats everything. So this is very interesting. The chimp on the right has a full understanding that he needs the partner. That's why he activates the partner. So that's part of many cooperation experiments nowadays. Do you understand cooperation when you cooperate? And also the partner is willing to work even though the partner is not interested in the food. So why would that be? Why would that be? Tit for tat. Yeah, it's a reciprocity. Chimps are very strong at reciprocity. They do that all the time. And these 2 chimps probably live together and do each other favors all the time. So then we tested elephants. Elephants are always very complicated and difficult. And it's, for example, it's impossible to develop a box that only one elephant can pull, you know? So we have a different design. And in this case, it's an apparatus with a rope around it. And it's a single rope. If you pull on this side of the rope, it disappears on the other side. So the 2 elephants have to pick up the rope at exactly the same time. And then we make life more difficult by withholding one of them. And I'll show you how that goes. So this is the elephant study on cooperation.
In Thailand, Dr. Josh
can I have a bit more sound?
Team have devised a unique challenge to find out. Using a sliding table, some rope, and an irresistible reward. So here's the problem. The elephants need to be able to pull the table closer to gain access to the sunflower seeds. And they need the rope to do that. But if only one of them pulls the rope, then they both go hungry. Can they work together to solve a novel problem?
Prom cap!
And more importantly, do they actually understand the concept behind it? The first time the elephants are shown this task, they fail. But this is a necessary part of the learning process. And something is definitely going on in there. A 4-kilogram brain is working it out.
The first thing I think that they learn, and there has to be some learning involved in this is a task they've never experienced before. The first thing is that they've learned that their partner needs to be there. And I think in some ways they've learned not only does their partner need to be there, but their partner needs to be doing something.
It doesn't take them long to figure it out. But Josh needs to prove that their brain power allows them to understand what's going on. So he releases one elephant before the other in the hope it'll wait for its partner. This moment of waiting is key. Josh gets the answer he was looking for.
What you're seeing is that the elephants are thinking about cooperation. And that actually demonstrates how smart and how well adapted these animals are.
It's all very well proving that animals understand cooperation. But how does it help them to survive in the wild?
So interesting detail here. He mentions the 4-kilogram brain of the elephant. Sort of interesting discussion we had. It's like 5 years ago, a scientist said we should not look at brain size at all. We should just count the number of neurons in a brain, and that will tell us how intelligent the animal is. Don't matter with size. And that was all perfectly fine. Humans had the most neurons, and everyone was happy. Then they counted the elephant. The elephant has 3 times more neurons than humans. They didn't know what to do with the elephant after that. So they went back to the old weight measure. That's how it always goes. So now I have a choice to make. I can go 5 minutes over time, if that's okay. Yeah. Or I can step back and we do questions and answers. No, we go on? Okay. By acclamation. So the cooperation study we did on chimps, the intention was to have chimps pull at an apparatus, but, more important, instead of us making the partnerships, like you do it with the... we gave them free choice. And so we had the whole group present, meaning 20 chimpanzees, meaning that everyone is there, meaning that there can be a lot of competition, because that means that not only can you freely choose your partners, but there can be dominant individuals who step in and kick you away or steal your food, or it can be freeloading. There's all sorts of stuff that can happen. And if chimps have trouble with competition, this should become one big bickering mass of chimpanzees, basically. So that's what we wanted to test. And there was some competition. Here you have a female who tries to get rid of someone at the apparatus, and she starts dragging at her and pulling at her. So yes, they do that, but we call this mild competition because chimpanzees have teeth and they can potentially even kill each other. This is nothing for a chimpanzee. This is really nothing. You know, I've worked with a lot of chimpanzees, and I can tell you for one thing, chimpanzee males have 5 times human arm strength. I don't know if you know that. But I still remember as a student playing with young chimpanzees, and I would hit them as hard as I could on their backs, in a way that any human would scream and yell and beat the shit out of you after you did that. But the chimps kept laughing and they thought this was the funniest thing ever. So that is how chimps are, you know? So this is nothing for them. I'll show you a video of the cooperation task before I show you the data. So here we have the apparatus. It's mounted on their outside enclosure. They have to look at each other. You will see that. They need to pull at exactly the same time. So that's why they're looking at each other. And then food will come out. It's very simple. We never trained them on this. We just gave them the apparatus and they had to figure it out. Now you have 3 of them who need to do it. It's more difficult. They can do that too. They look at each other and then they pull at the same time and they get the food. Now you get these little competitions that happen all the time. Alpha female walks away, a young female moves in, starts to pull. As soon as she gets food, the alpha female comes back to try to steal it. So that's a typical sort of stuff that's always going on. This is a female who gets rid of a male. She's not dominant over the male, but she knows how to move him. Mild competition. And then we have these very interesting scenes where chimps come together. So two, sometimes even three, they walk together to the apparatus. We don't know how they make the arrangement, how they communicate that we're going to work together on the apparatus, but that's clearly what they do. They sometimes recruit others. They go into the climbing frame, take someone out, and bring them to the apparatus. And so there's a lot of coordination that's going on that shows that it's very highly cooperative. Now, the data is interesting. It runs from plus one here for every session that we do. Plus one means that all the interactions are positive and cooperative. Minus one would be if all of them are negative and competitive. And zero is sort of balance between the two. And if you look well, you see that they start quite cooperative, and then they become more and more competitive. And this is because more and more chimps learn how to do this. More and more of them get involved. And so that increases the competition. And if we had stopped here, which is at 45 sessions, we would have concluded that they're not particularly good at it. But we kept going. We did 100 of them. And this is what we found. So they became actually very good at it and extremely cooperative, almost 100%. Basically, this is like a 5-to-1 ratio, is five positive and cooperative acts versus one negative or competitive one, which is exactly the one that Gottman has given us for human organizations and marriages. So Gottman works on marital relationships. That's how he got started. And so if you have a marriage in which there's five positive acts versus every negative one, you're probably okay. If you have a one-on-one ratio, I think you need to get a counselor or something like that. That's a Gottman's data. So, but actually the 5-to-1 ratio is what he says is typical of human organizations. And so that's exactly what we found in our chimpanzees. And so the conclusion is that they're very good at handling the competition. Okay, the last thing I want to treat is our fairness studies. That has gotten so famous with the capuchin monkeys. But we have done many other studies, and studies on dogs and crows, and it has gotten sort of out of control now. But I'm going to give you the original study that I did with Sarah Brosnan. We discovered by accident that the capuchin monkeys were sensitive to rewards, to the reward division. So this doesn't make any sense. If you are a traditional Skinnerian who works on rats, for example, you test your rat in a little box alone, and he gets rewards, and all you count is how much effort went into it and how many rewards do you get out of it. Reward schedule, it's usually called. So that's all that matters. And what we found in the capuchin monkeys is that they look at their neighbor. If the neighbor gets a better deal, they're upset about that. That's ridiculous. You should not be upset about it. You should just focus on what you did and what you get for it, but they keep comparing. And so that's why we set up this experiment where you have two monkeys side by side. You can give them grapes for a task, and grapes are perfectly fine food, and they will do the task many times in a row. You can give them cucumber for the task, very good food, they will do it many times in a row. Or you give one of them grapes, the other one cucumber. Now, it happens to be that grapes are far better than cucumber. So the preferences of my monkeys, they correspond precisely with the prices in the supermarket. And grapes are a more expensive food, and that's because there's sugar in the grape. And we are all primates, and that's what we go for. So here we are. This is the outcome of the experiment, a very simple task. If both of them get cucumber, they perform the task almost 100% of the time. If your partner gets grape and you're still getting cucumber, you perform only 50% of the time. So now you're rejecting. This is, according to the economists, this is irrational behavior. If I give you $1 and I give your neighbor $1,000, you may be very disappointed, but you should take the dollar. You should not refuse that dollar, because $1 is better than no dollar. But you may actually refuse the dollar. You may be so pissed that you refuse the dollar. So that's irrational, and that's the irrational response that my monkeys are showing. And then if you give the grape to the partner doesn't even need to work for the grape, gets it for free, then they really don't want to do it anymore. And that means that they're sensitive to effort. We are very sensitive to effort, too, in fairness principles. So if my salary is twice your salary, and we have the same job and the same experience and so on, that seems very unfair, at least to you. To me, it's okay. It seems very unfair to you. But if I work day and night and I don't take vacations and you're sort of lazy, well, then it makes a lot of sense that I get more than you. So let me show you the video that has now been seen by more than 100 million people. And the reason it has been downloaded so often is that people send it to the head of their department to get a raise in their salary or something like that. So here we have a monkey who works for cucumber, and this one works for grape, and you will see how that goes. This one gives us a rock, which is the task, gets a cucumber, eats it right away. So the first piece of cucumber is still perfectly fine. The other one needs to give us a rock, gets a grape. The one on the left looks at that, gives us a rock, gets cucumber again. The other one gets a grape again. Gets cucumber again. So, this is the irrational response. And the reason you react so strongly is because you're all into primate behavior. And we all know what this means. So that's why you identify. So when we first published this, sort of interesting background here, we didn't use the word fairness. We called it inequity aversion. But of course, the media immediately called it the fairness, and that the monkeys had a sense of fairness. And we got several angry letters. Actually, we got one from a guy who told us that we must be communists because we believed in fairness. And I look at my monkeys as very capitalistic. I think they're comparing what you get for, you know, for effort is, I think, capitalistic principle right there. Then there was another, was a philosopher who said it's impossible that monkeys have a sense of fairness because fairness was invented during the French Revolution. So now, I've written quite a bit about the evolution of morality, and I look at it completely the other way around, is that instead of thinking that morality is some sort of principles that are formulated, let's say a bunch of old guys in Paris who decide fairness is a great principle that we need to apply in society, and then all the other people like in Denmark and Holland and everything say, oh, it comes out of Paris, it must be good, you know, fairness. So that kind of thinking about morality is completely wrong. I think morality, I'm very Humean, David Hume. It comes out of the moral sentiments, it comes out of the emotions, and that's the emotions you see at display here. But I usually try to calm down, to console actually the philosophers, because I'm a very empathic person, and I would reassure them and say, well, actually the monkey sense of fairness is very egocentric, because the one who gets the grape is not bothered at all. That one is perfectly fine. And so it's a very egocentric sense of fairness. But then we started testing chimps. And so Sarah Brosnan started doing tests on chimps and found that in some pairs of the chimps, the one who gets the grape will refuse the grape until the other one also gets a grape. Now we're getting very close to the human sense of fairness, and then we started doing the ultimatum game on them, which is sort of, ultimatum game has been played all over the world with humans and all over the world, even places that have never heard of the French Revolution, they have a sense of fairness. So we started playing the ultimatum game on children and chimpanzees and basically found no difference. And if you now ask me what is the difference in the sense of fairness of humans and chimpanzees, I would not know. I think there's not much to tell you there. To close the lecture, I want to give you some children. There's all these mothers who do my monkey studies on their children, even in a way that I would never get permission for at the university. And so what this mother did is she gave her boy a whole cookie and her girl a half cookie to see what would happen.
Cookies,
please. You want cookies? Daniel, here's one cookie.
Ma.
Anna, this one's for you.
Yeah.
Come on. Really?
So that's the same irrational response that we see here. It's all the more irrational because the girl is only half the size of the boy. I recently met a woman who had two dogs, one Chihuahua, one Great Dane, and she said that Chihuahua insisted on the same amount of food as the Great Dane. Now, that's unreasonable, I think. But anyway, that whole principle of fairness, I think, extends to a lot of species, not just to the monkeys and not just to the chimpanzees. And my feeling is always that if related species, and capuchin monkeys and humans are related species, if related species show similar responses under similar circumstances, you have to go with a similar explanation. You have to come up with one explanation for both. There has been a long tradition in the field of psychology and animal learning to make distinctions and to say, well, in animals we call it something else, and to accuse you of anthropomorphism if you use human terminology for animals. I feel if related species react the same way under the same circumstances, you come up with the same terminology and the same concepts. And that has always been my principle. And I thank all the people who work with me and do these experiments. And I thank you for your attention.